Blackstone Publishing presents Fortune Favors the Brave, an extraordinary memoir by Kiri Westby. Read for you today by the author, Kiri Westby. That's me. Dedication. May all beings be free. Author's statement. All of the events described in this book actually happened, and I've written about them as I witnessed and experienced them directly, though others present may recall them differently. Many names have been changed or invented to protect privacy and security, while some events have been compressed and some dialogue recreated. Capturing the past with words is a fickle business, and we must acknowledge that human memory is imperfect and partial. Our memories, however, inform our understanding of how life has uniquely shaped us, and for me, it's less important to recall exact details and more illuminating to examine how big events and their lingering footprints play into the choices I've made. Within these pages, I've attempted to paint an accurate picture of what took place in my past, while focusing my recollections on the transformations that occurred within me along the way. Chapter 1. Chinese Prison.
Who made the cig?
Scary fat man spits as he yells in my direction, tiny droplets dotting the space between my drooping body and his rotund mass, shaking with anger. He hardly fits in his military uniform, and since he's removed his jacket, his dress shirt is coming untucked at the waist, revealing the soft flesh of his belly. It's the most animated I've seen him, or any of my Chinese captors, since I was arrested with four other American protesters at Mount Everest Base Camp 2 days ago. Most of the characters in this charade tread quietly, letting their leaders lead. Others, like Angry Dark Man in the corner, practically turned to stone the moment he sat down. He stares silently, unceasingly, exposing me under all this goose down and neoprene. I'm still wearing the layers of donated mountain gear, sponsored through Students for a Free Tibet, the Tibetan independence organization that recruited me for this mission. I put home out of my mind and try to pretend Angry Dark Man is stone, and therefore can't hurt me.
Who carried the fire alarm?
He pounds his fat fist on the bedside table, emphasizing frustration, making sure I understand that he is not fucking kidding. The big problem is I keep bursting into laughter. I bite my tongue hard to prevent more giggles until I taste blood, but it's a lost cause. I can't stifle them. What the fuck is he talking about? Scary Fat Man looks like he might snap if I don't stop insulting him in front of his colleagues, and while I know this could bring his interrogation to a far more painful point, I honestly don't know what he's asking. His insistence that I do is making the whole charade absurd, like Laurel and Hardy hysterical, and I wish my dad were here to see it. I wish anyone else were here to see this, but most likely, at this point, no one will ever hear my story about that one time my Chinese interrogator used an old electronic translator and came out sounding like a broken robot. That thought is strong enough to finally freeze my relentless chuckles. My throat is sore and crusty. Dust and vomit compounded with 40 hours of through-the-teeth lying. I don't want to talk anymore. Even if I wanted to tell the truth now, at this point, we've gone so far off track that the path back to the truth seems impossible. They think my name is Weston, and that I'm from Laramie, Wyoming, so that is who I must become. There's nothing funny about my situation, and for the majority of the time since our arrest, I've been openly bawling, like snot on the sleeves, grief bawling, not laughing. Just last night, the worst held my head over a cliff as I retched and shook and prepared for my death. Fear vomiting, a raw, emotional, physical response to terror that caught me entirely off guard. There's probably some training manual for how to deal with this much fear at once, without spontaneously vomiting or uncontrollable laughter. But these are highly trained soldiers, working for the most oppressive political regime on Earth, and they broke me like a stick of butter. My response now, laughing right in my interrogator's face, is not bravado, nor obstinacy. It comes instead from a place of resignation, a detaching from my physical body, a total divestment in my future, a letting go of everything that was my life before the protest. And it's all
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.